We are going to talk about hemoglobin today, specifically this oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve. Why does it shift side to side? Do not be afraid. We're going to Penguin Prof this thing, and even Flops is here to help. I'm assuming some knowledge about the respiratory system, especially having to do with the gas exchange surfaces, these alveoli. And we're going to be looking at oxygen in particular here, because oxygen is not very soluble in water, unlike CO2. So the transport of oxygen requires a protein carrier, and that is what hemoglobin is. So hemoglobin is a protein that's made of four subunits, two alpha chains and two beta chains, and in the center of each, there is a heme group with iron at the center. This is what it really looks like, and those heme groups here are shown in green. Now, my analogy is going to be that hemoglobin is like a taxi with four seats. So this taxi has the ability to bind up to four molecules of oxygen gas. This is just a lot friendlier. Okay, so we're going to talk about a taxi cab. Now, the taxi cab has four seats. So when it is empty, how saturated with oxygen would you say this taxi is? Okay, not a difficult question. That's 0% saturated. What about when we load with one molecule of oxygen gas? What percent saturated would you call that? Yes, okay, that's 25% saturated. Here is 50%, here is 75%, and here is 100%. We're going to come back to this idea very shortly. The big picture here, I'm hoping you remember the two circuits of the heart. If you don't, please check out my video on the heart. So hemoglobin will move from the right side of the heart to the lungs, where it will pick up oxygen. This is called loading. Then the hemoglobin with the oxygens inside returns, goes to the left side of the heart, and then leaves the left side of the heart through the aorta to unload that oxygen to cells of the body. So that's unloading. In the lungs, the oxygen from the alveoli will diffuse into the blood and immediately get picked up by the hemoglobin. Oxygen really does not like to dissolve in blood plasma, so that's why the taxi is needed. This is called loading. Then the hemoglobin taxi will go out through the left side of the heart, and it will unload that oxygen to cells in the body. And the cells, of course, will use this oxygen for cellular respiration. Okay, so you with me so far? This is loading, that is when hemoglobin picks up oxygen in the lungs, and this is unloading, when hemoglobin will release that oxygen to cells of the body that need it. Here is the question: what determines whether or not that taxi will load or unload passengers? Remember, it doesn't have a brain, right? It doesn't know what it's supposed to do. There are two factors. The first thing is how many passengers there are around. And the second is harder to understand. It's how much the taxi wants the passengers. That is an affinity, okay? And so conditions will change the shape of the taxi. This is where the analogy kind of breaks down, but just go with me on this. We'll get there. The body conditions will affect the shape of the hemoglobin or the taxi. Let's call this a high affinity cab, meaning oxygen wants to bind here. And this is a low affinity cab, okay? I mean, seriously, would you get in that? Okay, let's make it more sciencey now. What determines what direction this loading and unloading reaction goes? First, how much oxygen there is. We are going to use PO2, the partial pressure of oxygen, to describe that. And second is how much the hemoglobin, air quotes, wants the oxygen. That is hemoglobin oxygen affinity. And that is really going to be the key, because the conditions around the hemoglobin will change its shape. And now we have the infamous hemoglobin oxygen dissociation curve. Okay, let's do this. This curve describes the relationship between how much oxygen there is and how saturated hemoglobin proteins will be. Okay, along the x-axis, this is PO2. That is how much oxygen is there around the hemoglobin that you're looking at. So it goes from zero, and then we increase the amount of oxygen. A typical resting cell will have a PO2 of about 40 millimeters of mercury. And in the alveoli, you're looking at closer to 100 millimeters of mercury, okay? So the X is how many passengers there are. The Y-axis is the average percent saturation of all the taxis. So at the origin, we have 0% saturation. That means all the taxis are completely empty. And up here at the very top, we have 100%. That means all the taxis are completely full of oxygen.
So when we go up on the Y, that is hemoglobin loading with oxygen. And when we go down on the Y, that is hemoglobin unloading oxygen. Now, one erythrocyte can have about 300 million taxis on it. Okay, so this is an average. It's the average percent saturation of all taxis. Okay, so let's see how we read this. At a typical resting cell PO2 of about 40 millimeters of mercury, you come up and you see where 40 intersects this curve. You'll notice it is a sigmoidal shaped curve. And then you go across and see where it hits the Y. And that is somewhere around, let's call it 73%. So what does that mean? It means that when the hemoglobin is exposed to a PO2 of 40, 73% of all the seats are occupied with oxygen. What about in the alveoli? At 100 millimeters of mercury, we come up, we see where it hits the curve, and then we draw to the left, and we read that at about 97%. So this means, again, 73% saturated at a PO2 of 40, and 97% saturated at a PO2 of 100. So as the partial pressure of oxygen increases, hemoglobin loads more. And as the partial pressure of oxygen decreases, hemoglobin unloads more. So in our analogy, as the number of passengers goes up, taxis load, and as the number of passengers goes down, taxis unload. But here's the thing, we're gonna start changing the shape of the taxi now. The environment that the hemoglobin is in changes its shape. Let's look at pH. So now we've got three curves here and we're gonna compare the different pHs and see how that affects saturation. First, 7.6, this yellow curve. Now we're holding the number of passengers constant in all these cases, okay? But at a pH that's more alkaline, we get a percent saturation of about, let's call it 82%. pH of 7.4 is maybe 73%. This is actually the curve we just looked at a second ago. And when conditions are acidic, 7.2, all the taxis are about 61% saturated. So as pH goes up, hemoglobin loads more. As pH goes down, hemoglobin unloads more. This is due to the shape change of hemoglobin. The affinity between hemoglobin and oxygen is changing as the pH changes. Let's keep going and we'll make sense of this. What about temperature? So again, now you try it. Pick a PO2, you can stick with 40 if you like, and see what happens as the temperature changes from 37, which is normal body temperature. What about when temperature decreases and goes to 20? These are not necessarily physiologically relevant numbers, okay? It's just to illustrate what happens to the curve. And now see what happens when the temperature increases to 43. Okay, as temperature increases, hemoglobin unloads more. And as temperature decreases, hemoglobin loads more. Okay, let's look at one more, the partial pressure of CO2. When the partial pressure of CO2 goes down, the curve shifts to the left and the saturation goes up. When the partial pressure of CO2 goes up, the saturation goes down and we see the curve shifts to the right. So as PCO2 goes up, hemoglobin unloads more. And as PCO2 goes down, hemoglobin loads more. Flops wants a summary, which I think is a good idea. So this curve shows the relationship between how much oxygen there is and how saturated all of the hemoglobins are. But there's a dynamic element to this relationship because the environment can change the shape of the hemoglobin and that will change its binding affinity with oxygen. So the curve shifts to the right when the body demand for oxygen increases. This causes a decrease in that hemoglobin oxygen affinity and we call it a Bohr shift. This happens, for example, during exercise, when body temperature goes up, PCO2 goes up, and pH goes down. We see a shift to the left when the body demand for oxygen decreases. This causes an increase in binding affinity between oxygen and hemoglobin, and this occurs when, for example, body temperature goes down, PCO2 goes down, and pH goes up. Okay, you are most welcome. Hey, that is a good idea. So now you should be able to answer this question. Between the mother and the fetus, whose hemoglobin has a higher binding affinity? Hey, call your mom. As always, I hope that was helpful. Thank you so much for visiting the Penguin Prof channel. Please show me some love by slamming some buttons below, and I will see you in the next one. Good luck.